invite you all to be seated. In the sadness of today, we come to remember Michael Joseph Bray. Together with Mick's children, Julie, Jeff and Tracy and Karen, with Susan, with David and Tammy, Emily, remembering Kane, who's not able to be here, and also Jennifer and Duncan and Cameron, who are in the UK. So we gather with the Bray and Wellington families to say farewell, to remember the goodness of Michael, and to commend him to Almighty God. So as we come together to trust in God, let us pray. Almighty and merciful and faithful Father, Creator, of all things are of your making, all people are shaped in your image. We now entrust the soul of Michael Joseph Bray to your goodness. In your infinite wisdom and power, work in him your merciful purpose, known to you alone from the beginning of time. Console the hearts of those who love him, in the hope that all who trust in you will find peace and rest in your kingdom. Lord, Mick is now gone from this earthly dwelling, has left behind those who mourn his absence. Grant that as we grieve for him, may hold his memory dear and live in the hope of the eternal kingdom, where you'll be bring us together again. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the book of the Apocalypse. I, John, heard a voice from heaven say to me, "Write down, happy are those who die in the Lord. Happy indeed," the Spirit says. "Now they can rest forever after their work, since their good deeds go with them." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Think of the love that the Father has lavished on us by letting us be called God's children. And that is what we are. Because the world refused to acknowledge him, therefore it does not acknowledge us. My dear people, we are already the children of God, but what we are to be in the future has not yet been revealed. All we know is that when it is revealed, we shall be like him because we shall see him as he really is. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, Jesus said to the crowd, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I shall not turn them away, because I have come from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of the one who sent me. Now the will of the one who sent me is that I should lose nothing of all that he has given to me, and that I should raise it up on the last day. Yes, it is my Father's will that whosoever sees the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and that I shall raise them up on the last day." The Gospel of the Lord.
We come now to remember Mick's life, and so we have the eulogy, and if anyone else would like to share, please feel free to join after the family. Thank you.
Hey, thank you for coming. My name's Jeff. I'm the eldest son. I live in New Zealand. So it's great to be back because this will probably be the first time I speak in public or on video and not be subtitled, which seems to happen quite a lot when I'm in New Zealand. So if anybody doesn't really understand me, just raise your hand and I'll slow down. Let's talk about Dad. My father, Mick, was a really humble man who was actively involved in many parts of the Mount Isa community. He had a very strong faith and was adored by his family. His kindness endeared him to many of those he met, and it's a great testament to his nature that he formed so many long-lasting friendships over the years. So thank you very much to all those that are here today, watching online here around the country in New Zealand, and Jenny over in the UK. And to everybody else that's contacted us over the last couple of weeks, it really means a lot to us and the family. Dad was born on Tuesday, the 70th of November, 1936. Whew. That was a while ago, wasn't it? To Harold and Lily Bray in Mount Isa. He was the third of seven children, with the older brother Vincent and Kevin, the youngest brothers Tom, Christopher, and younger sisters Teela and Veronica. As a child, the family lived on the mine side of town, and in a cottage with no hot water or refrigeration. I couldn't do hot water. I've got to do hot water. That would do my head in. To not have a hot shower, or to have a hot shower, he and his two older brothers would meet Dad after work and shower with the miners. And on weekends, his siblings would ride their bikes out to Micah or Spear Creek. And at Micah Creek, they would let water out of the taps. on the pipeline from Rifle Creek to have a bit of a bath, which kind of defeats the purpose because then they'd ride all the way back and get covered in dust. But hey, that's what they did. They'd also slide down the slag or the sandy heaps, and for those overseas that don't know what slag heap is, it's a big pile of dirt. and that was kind of what we called fun back in those days, good times before the internet. They would probably do it on tin, but most of the times they just did it on their bums. So they would get in trouble from their mum as they would wear at the bottom of their pants. So he attended St. Joseph's Covenant School up to grade 8, and then completed grade 9 and 10 to Mount Carmel College in Charters Towers. It would take him nearly 2 days on the train. Has anybody been on the train here? Has it gotten any faster? No, I didn't think so. No, of course it doesn't. To get to school and back. And sometimes if they got bored, they would hop off the train and walk beside it. And then get back on it. Probably walked home quicker. We found his report card from the Mount Carmel College with an A for maths and science, which is not surprising because Dad loved his maths. He was always calculating everything. We'll talk about chisels later. Although he didn't quite live up to that expectation in English, and we won't tell you what he got for that. In December 1954, he joined Mount Isa Mines as an electrical apprentice, and he worked as an electrician in many parts of the mines, including underground, the workshops and the power plant out at Mica. He continued as an electrician until 1966, and then he moved to a staff role of diesel parts foreman. He stayed in this role until his retirement in 1988, after 45 years of service. He was a well-known figure at Bellamoia, the Toyota dealership. I was a well-known figure there because I had a Toyota and it kept breaking down. And at one stage, actually, Bellamoia thought he was one of their employees. So I'm not too sure how that worked. So Dad sadly lost both his parents when he was still young, his mum in his early 20s and his father in his late 20s. He stayed with Dad after Mum's death to help him with the younger siblings. And after his father's death, he continued to care for the youngest, Veronica. In his 20s, Dad found his passion for horse racing. Yeah. This would be a lifelong love for him. Don't look at me like that. Bernie Comfort. and he would bet quite large amounts, £320 on one horse one day, and would travel around to see all the races. Him and Maurice Smith would lay their winnings out on the front lawn and stand back and admire their handiwork. And then for a while there, I was reported to know he was the bane of all the local bookies, as he would leave after they'd won, so they couldn't chase their money back. Yeah, that sums up Dad to a T. He was very thrifty. He did continue betting even after his marriage, even though the amounts drastically reduced to like about $1 to $5. In his final days down in Brisbane, he was still betting. Of course he was. He always betted. And following the horses, Julie did stress him out one day, though, when she accidentally placed a $50 bet rather than a $5 bet for the win. A hurried cancellation, new bet for the correct amount followed. But Julie was right, and the horse came in, and it was paying, about $8. So after that, I do remember many a Skype call regaling either his victories or poor choices. And quite often, they were poor choices. Well, he'd pick the right one, and then he'd go change his mind, wouldn't he? Yeah, of course he would. So Dad was very involved also in the 10-pin bowling in his 20s, including being a league team leader. He earned the government 250 pin and had an average of over 200. Anybody bowled here? Hey, don't do it. It's terrible. Just get angry. One of the lovely employees down the bowling alley caught his eye. She was a bowling teacher and had a lower average. So I don't know what he was actually learning. So he asked her out on a movie date, and she replied that she had seen that movie 3 times. Yeah, luckily, he persisted, and 2 years later, on Saturday, the 4th of December, 1965, he married the love of his life, Elsa. They had over 54 years of happy marriage, and they meant the world to each other. So Dad and Mum moved into 8 Inner Street on the 7th of April, 1970. We were so grateful that Dad got to live his life out in that house and shared it with Mum. His other great love in life was his children, me, Julie, and the rest. Susan, Jenny, and David. Yeah, he had an attachment to them. Yes, he quite liked them. He was a very involved father, coming home at 4 p.m. on the Honda 90, which was a sight to see him blasting down the road, getting the maximum out of that thing, which was still under the speed limit, I must admit, which was quite good. And he used to come home and he used to be a part of our lives as soon as he got home, and we loved his bedtime stories. When our maternal grandmother died and Mum went to Cairns for 2 weeks and left Dad in charge for 2 weeks, I remember him ringing up Mum one night and scandalised that we had to change David's nappy. And Dad, being the ever-efficient man, took him outside, stripped him down and hosed him off. You know, over the grass, of course, because he wanted to make it grow and we were probably on water restrictions. So, you know, two birds with one stone, that was great. I think Dave was having the time of his life out there. You still do that? He grew his beard while Mum was away. Yeah, that was a first. And he always tormented us with his whiskers. Now, mind you, he did shave it off the night before she came home. He did mean the world to us. He loved being a grandfather to Karen, Kane, Emily and Cameron. And so we'll get a few words from them. So when asked about her granddad, Karen recalled one of her favourite memories that stuck out right away. Now, I do remember this one too. Granddad had the ability to make the best Vegemite butter on toast. It is a skill. It really is a skill. She always got really excited when she was little to have him make toast for breakfast. He somehow always had the perfect ratio and cut it into four little triangles for me, which felt so special every time. That is special. Who cuts their toast into triangles now? Raise hands. No, good work. My other favourite memory was just getting him to witness him having fun, whether it be at my 21st with Grandma, in the photo booth, which I must admit took a fair bit of convincing by Tracy to get him in there. I do think we have a photo of that later, and you'll see why. And having the time of his life at her wedding, dancing around with Emily, which was a sight to see. I think Emily was leading. And watching him play card games. You know, just being there truly lit us, made us all light up, and he was truly the best. Kane was lucky to have Granddad and Grandma in his life. They played such an important role, particularly through his early years at Mount Isa, and they were super fierce advocates of him throughout their lives. Emily's favourite memory of Granddad was how, when she was younger and they would do FaceTime calls, she remembers showing off all her gymnastic moves. Were they good? They weren't the best, were they? It says they weren't the best, but I wasn't going to say that. They were the best, eh? He would laugh and clap and have a great old time, and sometimes I'd see him moving around the side of the thing to see where you went, you know, like that. And he used to love that. He thought you were the best. Cameron remembers Granddad, and I do like this one, because we'll come back to this point. Cameron remembers Granddad. So when I came to visit Granddad at his house, I went looking for some cheesels. Does anyone know what cheesels are? Yep. For the people overseas who know what cheesels are, they're a round sort of imitation cheese thing that crunches, and they're incredibly great. They're fantastic. Granddad disappeared somewhere and came out with four boxes. I was so excited when Granddad saw that, and when Granddad saw this, he looked at me and smiled and promptly gave me the box with only half in it and went and hid the other three. I never found the other boxes, but Granddad did take me to Woolies to get some of my own, probably from his own money too. When I visited Australia when I was six, the family went to dinner at the Kenmore Tavern, which is a tradition for the Brays. We love migrating to the Kenmore Tavern, and we'll probably be doing it this Saturday. I sat next to Granddad and Grandma. I said to Granddad, "I want a garlic bread." And he looked at me and said, "Yuck." So garlic is a forbidden fruit in our, or forbidden vegetable in our house. So are most spices. Anything with flavour is pretty much forbidden in our. So it was kind of a big deal when Cameron said he wanted garlic bread and Dad didn't just run out of the Kenmore Tavern. So Dad said, "Yuck," but they got it anyway. So during dinner, Granddad would try and steal chips. His and Emily's chips. So they waved the garlic bread above him, but this didn't stop Dad because he's a determined man. So Emily and I just rubbed the garlic bread over the chips and that stopped him pretty much straight away. Grandma sat there, shook her head and told him serves himself right, he should have got his own chips. So Dad was a keen sportsman, with the following being just some of the sports he excelled at during his life. when we were cleaning out the cupboard at one stage, I came back home for Mum to put more handicraft stuff in. Is there any handicraft ladies here? The team? Yep, you'll know Mum. To place her handicraft hoard in, we found at least a carload of trophies. And these included 10-pin bowling, cricket, boxing, tennis, golf, darts, and rugby. So Dad tried out for rugby at boarding school, but because he was so light, he had to put on a bunch of, they had to make weight, and he had to put a bunch of extra clothes on to make weight. He came up short, so he went outside and put rocks in his clothes, and came back inside, still came up short. So he told me he played rugby, but I really don't think he played rugby, because I've seen rugby players in New Zealand, they're really big, you know, and Dad wasn't big, he was a small man. But he was such a natural sportsman, so much that one year in the mid-80s, he went to a tennis doubles competition after playing for many, many years. It was probably about 10, 15 years he hadn't played. And he was out of practice. He speculated he'd be knocked out in the first round or two. So with that confidence, Mum packed us kids in the car in the Holden Kingswood and we went down to support him, you know, all full of enthusiasm and bravado. 8 hours later, he's still playing. The enthusiasm's waning. We got to the finals. In the evening, we were at about hour 12. The enthusiasm was long gone. Mum wasn't too impressed. And then we get to the finals thinking, well, we should be all right. And he goes and gets knocked out in the finals. So that whole day, we went there and he came home second. And the next day, we couldn't walk the next 2 days. He was sort of hobbling around. I do remember that. Mum didn't talk to him for at least the drive home. So Dad was also very competitive with board games and card games, and we played those pretty much every Saturday night on the TV. If we had the TV on, we'd turn it off and we'd be playing board games. There's many fierce competitions at home. He's also probably the most regular winner because he could count cards. Unless we ganged up on him, he'll put two or three sets of cards in there or use the cards I had, which were missing cards. Also, once when I was working over the mines over at the workshops there, Dad came out and saw me for lunch. And it's a big tradition. I don't know if it's still a tradition over in Mount Isa in the crib rooms to play 500. So we used to play a lot of 500 when I was underground, and Dad played a lot of 500. So he said, come on, boy, we'll come play 500 with these two guys and these roosters. And I got up there, and I made a call. I was confident, made a call. I thought it was about 9 no trumps or something. I was like, yeah, we're going to win this one. I obviously missed the signs. We went down. We went out. Dad pulled me aside and asked me what I was doing. He said I was the worst 500 player partner he's ever had. He came out the week later and he wouldn't partner me again. I said, oh, come on, one bad call. He said, didn't you see the signs? I said, you look a poker face. I did not see anything. So that was my brief my 500 buddy experience with Dad. Never played again with him. He would just look at me and go pick someone else. Another great passion of my dad's was because he was loved his mathematics. He could count cards, but he could also count money. Boy, could he count money. He saved money like a bank manager to the point he would take us kids out to collect dry cow pads for the garden compost along the old dam road. And when in Brisbane, instead of buying us individual drinks, he'd buy a 2 litre of fake orange juice. Excuse me, try and tell us it was real orange juice. We knew it was fake, come on. And then proceed to ration it out in glasses. He couldn't go past a bargain, my father. And he sought him out like a bloodhound. When I came home, I found 17 boxes of chocolate and an equal amount of cheesels and chips all secreted away in the little troves around his house. I mean, Dad loved the cheesy goodness of the golden cheesel. And the funny thing about the cheesels was that he would ration them. So he would open up the cheesel box, and he'd take about 3 or 4, and then he closed up, put a peg on it, draw a line. So when the sisters came out and they started eating the cheesels, you could see these eyebrows go up, and you could see he was like working at NASA Space Station, and the maths was going through his head about how many cheesels less would he eat to make this block last the same time. Oh, it was fascinating. He could do it, and then you'd see him the next night, like about 3/4 of a cheesel, and I'll be like, what are you doing? You got like 12 boxes up there. So that was great dad's passions was maths and saving things. And he loved his maths right up to the point, you know, he passed away. He was incredibly sharp on his mathematics. You know, he had a wicked sense of humour, which was probably not always seen, but it was seen by the ladies down there at the craft group when one day he said he heard on the radio that Spotlight had gone into receivership. And yeah, that didn't go down too well at all. Mum had strong words with him when she got home. And she took it out on him by obviously taking him down the Spotlight and making him walk around there. Dad's other great skill was patience. And he would walk around a Spotlight to minimise the damage, obviously, with the money. And he would... I mean, I've done some long walks in my time in the military, but that three-hour walk around Spotlight would break any strong person. But he did it, right up to the point he, Julie, decided that she moved his Spotlight, and once she said, oh, I'll do that, and that Dad took that as a cue never to do it again, he sat outside, which was quite good. You know, so that became Julie's job. And we've got many photos of her being incredibly happy in Spotlight. So Dad's last great passion was his faith, and he attended Mass regularly. After he retired, he often visited Laura Johnson home, and I was a hospital, and often read to them. He would often be seen in the wards visiting patients, talking with the staff, and he loved this place. He really did. So Dad made lifelong friends with many of those he met, and it's a testament to those people that are here today or have called us. He knew all his neighbours. He was a standing grandfather for all the kids on the street. And I can remember many a birthday coming home to the house, and there was a birthday party going, and I'm thinking, it's not my birthday. It's not Julie's birthday. It's not Susan's birthday. Is it Jenny's birthday? No. Kane, you got a bit? No. It'll be some kid down the street's birthday. Got a cake out. He's got the cheesels out. Rationed, of course. Lollies, the whole thing. And he'd be running around with a party hat on, and I'd be thinking, who the hell's this kid? That's Granddad. Oh, okay. So we would have had about 3 to 4 families would come over and they'd have parties at our place. And yeah, see, that's where Dad shined. The last thing I sort of want to talk about is Dad's health. He was blessed with fantastic health, and I'd wake up, I wouldn't wake up voluntarily at 6 o'clock every morning to hear him skipping or doing push-ups, and then him looking at me wondering why I wasn't doing the same thing. The neighbours, you would have seen him out there skipping all the time, up till his late 70s. I'm flat out getting out of bed and lifting my coffee cup at that time of the morning, you know. And he was a big believer in the, you know, in keeping fit and staying healthy. In honour of that, today I've wore pants that are slightly too tight and a bit too short on the ankle because Dad also loved wearing shorts. So I'll be showing off a bit of knee a bit later on. And that was what you always saw Dad do, was exercise and wearing shorts. He loved being fit and he loved staying healthy. Towards the end, he was ever thankful of the kindness and professionalism of the wonderful health staff that looked after him and Mum. And often he would speak to them, to us when he was at home, about the care they gave Mum and how highly he rated them. So we are glad to share our precious memories of our father with you today. He will be missed. Dad was a giant in our eyes, and we love him very much, and we will miss him.
Hi, I'm Tracy. I'm Jeff's partner, and I speak New Zealand. Unfortunately, there is no subtitles, so I'll speak slowly. I've asked if I could speak about Mick because he was an amazing man, and I was really proud to be part of the family and welcomed into it. I don't read very well, I'm dyslexic, so I'm just going to say some words and refer to some notes. And what I wanted to cover off was the things that Mick loved from what I saw. And first and foremost, he loved Elsa. Then his family, and as you've heard from Jeff, he loved them all equally. Even though they argued about who was the favourite in the family and who was going to get the Thermomix. He loved Father Mick and the church. He loved bargains. Aldi, the weirdest shop in the world. I can't understand how you can buy nappies and a whippersnipper in the same aisle. It's quite bizarre. He loved Holden's, shorts, walk socks, showing off his knees, horse racing, as you've heard, and he loved to deliberate on how to best invest that $2. And it was never $2 each way, it was only on the nose. He loved those cheesy flavoured snacks. Again, he loved bargains and saving money, cowboy movies, the rain radar, which was kind of bizarre to me living in Mount Isa because it doesn't rain that much. He loved baking cakes and tarts for the kids, and he loved the noise of all the kids and grandchildren getting together and talking all at once. He loved telling stories. He loved getting up early and eating his cereal really loudly, banging the spoon in the bottom of the bowl so that it would wake up everybody else, so that we could join him for skips and press-ups and sit-ups, which no one actually did. He loved people. He loved charity work and paying it forward. He loved music and rocks. "It's Mikey, you know, Tracy," he told me one time. "Feel the weight of that." My goodness. He loved Mount Isa. He loved saving, using solar energy and calculating exactly how much money he'd saved. And I think the power can be on an industry for the next 20 years without paying a bill. He loved his green lawns and his gerberas. He loved his independence. And he really loved the neighbours and the neighbours' kids, as you've heard from Jeff. He loved standing outside Spotlight when Julie took over the reins and went in with Mum. He loved toading, and he taught me how to flick toads up off the ground and smack them across into the neighbours. Sorry, neighbours. He loved life and laughing, and he did them both really well. And it really is an honour to be part of this great family. Thank you.
Hi. I'd like to share with you a few things I knew about Michael. Michael was the perfect gentleman. He was always neatly dressed and extremely punctual. I'd pick him up for Mass on Saturday night, and he'd be ready, standing on the front steps waiting for me. Mind you, I was never late, but he was always there standing at the steps waiting for me. Then all the way to Mass, we'd get the rundown on the Gigi's, how hopeless some of the jockeys were, how crazy the odds were, how he just missed by this much. But most times, he had a small win and just enough to do it all again the next Saturday. I know nothing about racehorses and even less about jockeys, but he thought I did, so I copped all the details. He really did love Saturdays, the online betting, Mass in the evening, and every time I asked him, "What's for dinner, Mick?" he'd say, "Butter chicken." Him and butter chicken, what's with the butter chicken? He used to love it, eh? But one time I picked him up for Mass, and he baked a date loaf, and he baked one for me. He knew I had a bit of a sweet tooth. Anyway, I told him, "Oh, I wish I had something to cut it so that I could sneakily have a piece, you know?" So the next time when he made me one, I opened it on the way home. He knew I'd sneakily have a look. And there on top was a small slice of the date loaf. I thought, you, little rat. That made me laugh because he didn't say anything to me at all. He just knew. He was really a sweetie. He really was. He and Ailsa would always be holding hands when they walked into Mass. You'd see them walking in, holding hands, and you'd say to yourself, "Aw, isn't that sweet?" And it would remind you of how lovey-dovey some people can be and that it's love that really keeps us together. And Michael loved to chat. Any visitors that come to Mass, he'd bail them up at the front door and make them feel welcome. Then he'd introduce them to us as if he knew them all his life. You'd see him talking to them and you'd swear they were old friends. Any questions, he'd have answers for them. He just loved talking about Mount Isa. With all the history he and Ailsa had collected, it's no wonder he could tell them all about the Isa. He had newspaper clippings and so many old photos that he would happily share with all of us. He even had a newspaper cutting of when I started at the mines back in 1975. Man, that's unreal, eh? I could say a lot more about Michael, or Mick as most people call him, but you already know what a lovely, kind, and exceptionally generous man he was. So now, Mary Jane, Brother Marty, and myself, when we sit in our usual spots here on Saturday night, as well as all the other parishioners, in our thoughts, in our prayers, and in our hearts, there will always be a Michael and an Ailsa right there with us. God now has Michael in his care, but we will always have him in our hearts. Thank you.
Hi everyone, it's lovely to be back here in Mount Isa, sorry. I'm Sarah. Our memory of Mick and Ailsa is a small but special one. They're like our Isaac grandparents. So for all of us and our children who came along to the craft group and we got to know Mick and Ailsa, they hold such a special place in our memories of Mount Isa. And they always will. So on behalf of all of our friends that couldn't be here today, thank you for sharing your beautiful father and your mother with us, because they're very special. Thank you.
Sometimes I whisper what I'm thinking of. My cup runneth over with love. Sometimes in the evening, when you see, I study the small things you do constantly. I memorize moments that I'm fondest of. My cup runneth over with love. Even runneth over with love. Perhaps love is like a resting place, a shelter from the storm. It exists to give you comfort, it is there to keep you warm. And in those times of trouble, when you are most alone, the memory of love will bring you home.
Perhaps love is like a window, perhaps an open door. It invites you to come closer, it wants to show you more. And even if you lose yourself and don't know what to do, the memory of love will see you through.
Oh, love to some is like a cloud, to some as strong as steel.
For some a way of living, for some way to feel.
And some say love is holding on, and some say letting go. And some say love is everything, some say they don't know.
Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain. Like a fire when it's cold outside, thunder when it rains. If I
of love will be of you. And some say love is holding on, and some say letting go.
And some say love is everything, and some say they don't know. Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain. Like a fire when it's cold outside, thunder when it rains.
If I should live forever and all my dreams come true, my memories of love will be of you. Just watching that brings back so many memories and other things we don't know. But I was beginning with family and the love that Mick had that gave him life and that he gave life to others through family. And one of the memories that came back when I was thinking of that was the young people from Germany. He met them at the hospital giving out communion, took them home, and they've kept contact ever since. It's an extraordinary way in which love has reached out beyond just family to the world family. It's why when I read in that letter of St. John, think of the love that's been lavished on us as God's children, as God's very own. I think Mick and with Ailsa, they knew that love that's been lavished on each other, and it's made a difference to themselves. So much so that it was lavished on so many other people and in so many ways, so many unknown ways. When we think of Mick's community interests, people from the credit union here, Mick was one of those founding members of the credit union. But the number of people that he used to call in, whether it's Tuesday mornings for a cuppa and a couple of families, or different people, I think particularly since Ailsa died,
Maybe it was out of loneliness, but it was also out of a real sense of friendship and love that Mick had. So much so that I think even when he went to the hospital of a Sunday and they'd say, "Father Mick brought me communion," I'd take the credit. And so happy are they who, as they're reading from the book of Revelations, Apocalypse reminds us, happy are they for their good deeds go with them. And so today there's a sense of happiness that we celebrate, for Mick was certainly full of good deeds. I always think of Mick as the taxi driver, you know, bringing people to craft, bringing people when he and Desley had the family history. He was sort of the person, the quiet one in the background who, I suppose he did what he was told, but he also was the person who looked after others in a great way. And I think Mount Isa probably doesn't realise the extent of what Mick and Ailsa did for the whole community, to keep history alive in a place where so many people come and go. History becomes so important. And their, particularly with the Comerfords, their work in trying to establish that whole history of Mount Isa becomes so important to us. That's why in the Gospel of John, Jesus said, "I should lose nothing of all that's been given to me." There's a sense in which their dying is reminded to us all to keep alive that gift of love. That gift of love they've given not only to family, but to our community, to the whole community. And so today, as we gather, thinking of Mick and Ailsa walking off into the distance, we give thanks for their life, and particularly today for Mick. We commend him to Almighty God. We pray for a deeper appreciation of his goodness, a reminder to us all then of the goodness that we can have, that we can share, that we can make a difference to so many other people. And so today, we give thanks for his life and commend him to Almighty God. So let us pray. Loving God, you raised Christ from the dead, and so with confidence we ask you to raise all people to eternal life.
That God receive our praise and thanksgiving for the life of Mick. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For Mick's family, especially Julie, Jeffrey and Tracy, Susan, Jenny and Duncan, David and Temmie, his loved grandchildren, Karen, Kane, Emily and Cameron, that they may feel the healing power of Christ in the midst of their pain and grief. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together in God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all the medical and health staff and ancillary physios that cared for Dad and his life, may their works of service be richly blessed. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
That we may welcome into glory our family and friends who have died, especially his loving wife, Mum, Ailsa, his parents, Harold and Lily, and his brother, Tom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For those unable to be present today, Jenny, Duncan and Cameron, and Dad's siblings, Vince and Helen, Kevin and June, Tila, Chris, Veronica and Patrick, that God's healing hand may be extended to them. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
God of mercy and love, you always listen to the cry of your people. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's pray these gifts of ours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Accept the sacrifice at your hands. Praise and glory of his name.
We humbly offer you these gifts, O Lord, for the salvation of Michael Bray. In your mercy, he did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour. May he find in you a merciful judge, for he lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is true, right, and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For as one alone Jesus accepted death, so that we might all come from dying to a new birth, so that in your sight we may all live forever. So with all the company of angels and saints, we too praise you as we acclaim. You're indeed holy, O Lord, you're the source of all holiness. Let your Spirit come upon us and upon these gifts that they may become for us, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The time is betrayed and entered into his passion. He took bread from the table and he gave you thanks and praise. And he broke the bread and gave it to his friend, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." At the end of the meal, he took the cup that was filled with wine, and he gave you thanks, handed the cup to his friends and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, will be shed for you and for all, that sins may be forgiven." And then he said, "Do this in memory of me." Together we proclaim this mystery of faith. So we celebrate the memorial of Jesus' death and resurrection. We offer you, Lord, this life-giving bread and saving cup. Thank you for counting us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. And so we humbly pray that we too may partake in the body and blood of Christ and be gathered together as one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Tim, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Mick Bray, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like this, like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
As we join together, let's pray the prayer that Jesus gave us, that God's kingdom may be on earth through the love that we've experienced, the face of God we've experienced in Michael. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Grace to grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." And so look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's offer one another a sign of peace. Lord Jesus, the one who gives us life, so happy all of us who open to receive him into our hearts today. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only so the word of my soul shall be healed. So for a moment, we give thanks for Michael Joseph Bray's life. Lord, you feed us with this gift of the Eucharist. May we rejoice together with Mick at the feast of eternal life in your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Into your gentle keeping, O Lord, we commend Mick. Though our hearts are troubled, we hope in your loving kindness. By the sign of the cross, he was claimed by Christ. In the waters of baptism, he died with Christ to live with him forever. May the angels, our guardians, lead Mick now to paradise, where your saints will welcome him and every tear will be wiped away. There we shall join in songs of praise forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow our heads and ask God's blessing upon us all. May the love of God and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ bless and console us in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May Mick rest in peace forever. Amen. In joyfulness, now trust in God as we carry Michael Joseph Bray to his final resting place.